Zolder in Belgium will once more play host for the final round of the 2019 NASCAR Wheel and Euro Series on the 5th and the 6th of October. In 2018, the racing was intense at the finals, but who's going to grab the wins in 2019? With so many quick rookies in Elite 2 this season, who is going to come out on top? And in Elite 1, could Alan Day make NASCAR history and secure three back-to-back titles? It's the finals, it's Zolder, it's double championship points. Who'll be celebrating and heading towards victory lane, and who will be crowned the champion? Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome along to Circuit Zolder in what is a rather wet and damp and quite grey day here in Belgium. It is the final round of the 2019 NASCAR Wheel and Euro Series. Therefore, we will be crowning champions today. Both of the championships are still up for grabs. It's the Elite 2 Championship that will be coming out onto the grid very, very shortly at this iconic circuit, which first opened in 1963 and, of course, continued to hold Formula 1 up until the 1980s. Its first ever Grand Prix was held here in 1973. The circuit we're racing on is the 4 kilometre or 2.5 mile circuit. NASCAR Wheel and Euro Series first raced here in 2005. And the winners from last year, Ulysse Delso and Guillaume de Flandre, are competing this weekend, but they've both stepped up to Elite One, so we won't see them on the grid. And remember, this is the last race of the season. The championship is still to be decided around this fantastic circuit. Well, yesterday we had a race both for Elite One and Elite Two in what were much drier conditions. So let's look back at some of the highlights from the action here yesterday. So yesterday in the Elite One race, it was a first career win in Elite One, at least, for Thomas Ferrando, a former Elite Two champion, stepping up to Elite One, claiming his first victory. And for Lassie Sorensen, it's his sixth career win in the NASCAR Wheel and Euro Series. All six of those coming this year because he's a rookie in the championship. And that win for him was an important one because it moves him to within 1 point of his main championship rival in this race that will be coming up very shortly. Giorgio Maggi is going to be the one he'll be rolling his sleeves up and slugging it out as who's going to be crowned the champion for 2019 in the Elite 2 division. We've got an Elite 1 driver that joins me in the commentary box. I'm delighted to say for the second time this year now, and 12 months ago he was in the commentary box also at Circuit Zolder. Mauro Trioni joins me. Good morning, Mauro.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome back, Mauro Trioni. I'm very happy to be back. Last year it was like in Italy, sunny, shining, warm. And now I feel like in England. I think you made it on purpose because you want to feel home, Mark. That's correct.
This is a good day at home, rest assured. Yeah, this is shorts and flip-flops weather for me, you know.
Yeah, but it's not fun driving, trust me.
No, just talk us through. We've had a few drivers that have sort of given their views about what it's like here in the wet at Circuit Zolder. You sampled that on Friday in the free practice sessions.
Yeah. So the problem is visibility, because I think the cars are not that difficult to drive when it's wet. They're very nice. Actually, I was very surprised. Even if there is no electronics, there is a lot of power, back-wheel drive. So you expect to have a very complicated situation. The reality is that these cars are nice. The problem is visibility, because the windshield is not glass. The wiper doesn't work so well with the windshield. Sometimes they stop. The air system inside is complicated, so I think that the main problem for everybody is going to be visibility.
Absolutely, and the drivers have had, the Elite 2 drivers that are just heading out onto circuit now, ready for their final race of the season, had a separate briefing. That took place only 35 minutes ago, where Jerome Galpin and Philippe Goudet, who is the race director, were saying, subject to the conditions, if the conditions stay as they are at the moment, which isn't that bad, if there is any deterioration in those conditions, they may consider either leaving the safety car out for longer and starting on the safety car, or possibly even having a single file restart rather than a 2x2, which hopefully might then get away from some of the issues we had in the Elite One race yesterday up at turn number one, which took out half a dozen cars.
Yesterday was a nightmare, let's say this. So everybody, this is the final, double points. There is still, especially look at this race, 1 point is separating Sorensen from Maggi. Everybody wants to push hard. It's wet, it's complicated, so we need to be really careful and avoid all the issues that we had in the race yesterday. So I agree with the race direction that should brief the drivers in a very accurate and correct way.
And what we do have, of course, is those two drivers you were talking about, Giorgio Maggi leading the championship by a single point from Lassie Sorensen, the big Dane, both of them rookies in the championship. Sorensen will start from pole position. Who'll be alongside him on the grid? Giorgio Maggi. It's just the greatest way to end the season. If I were one of those drivers, crumbs, I'd be feeling the pressure right now.
Yes. I like a lot both, sincerely. I was really surprised by the performance of Sorensen. The guy is extremely fast and extremely correct. So he's the one that I really want to see in the first line in conditions like this. And Giorgio Maggi is a correct driver as well. So I think that the problem might happen just behind them.
Yes, it wouldn't surprise me. I remember, just 2 weeks ago at Hockenheimring, the two of them went side by side through three or four corners, and there was just the lightest touch from either, and both of them giving each other just enough room. I spoke to Giorgio Maggi yesterday. We saw in the highlights of yesterday's race at one of the restarts, Giorgio Maggi was leading when the safety car came out, so he was on pole for the restart. And at turn one, Lassie Sorensen swept all the way around the outside, and Giorgio Maggi held his hand up and said, "I gave him too much room. I was too polite. It's going to be closer today."
Yes, but I prefer this kind of driving instead of what we saw lately. Hockenheim, yesterday in Zolder. Sometimes you ruin your race, you ruin your teammate, your friend's race, because at the end we are all friends. And it's a shame. So, and I think you need to be aggressive in the right way.
Yeah.
But sometimes, everybody, not just in Elite 2 or in Elite 1, they switch off the brain and they just try to go. And yesterday, after the first turn, there was, I think, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 cars were out of the race after one turn. It's unacceptable.
And I think that's what the briefings that have sort of been given to the drivers are absolutely now putting that into place to ensure that that the message is given across. Your race yesterday, you managed to escape all of the issues at the first corner. It was all going really, really well, and then you had a mechanical issue with the car.
Yeah, I was actually able to gain a lot of position in lap one, but it was from 22 to 9th.
Wow.
But then the race control put safety car inside. So if you don't finish the first lap, you have to
go back to
where you were. But I was able again to gain up to 13th. And start a nice fight with Blake Mullen, Sebastian. But then I had a clutch issue. So my car was spinning, from every corner when I was giving gas. And I did a mistake on the last chicane. I had to go through. I think I was the only driver in the history of NASCAR to give himself a drive-through, because everybody was, saying, "What happened? What happened to Mauro? He's in the pit lane," and I did it because I had to make a decision: sand or pit lane. So I entered the pit lane two laps at the end, and I was passed by five cars. Now we are still in contention for the podium of the Challenger Trophy, because the Tuomala is too far away, but me, Kazu, and Miura are within 4 points. So it's going to be fun today.
Yeah, the Challenger Trophy is for bronze and silver graded drivers, if you're not familiar, that enter the Elite One Championship. So was that a case of you were worried if you went into the gravel you'd get stuck in there, or you'd damage the car? So the safer option was to not have either of those issues and head down pit road?
Both, because I damaged the car so much this year, and I went into the gravel so much this year that I said, no, I want to go in the pit lane. I don't want to do it anymore.
You've been around motorsport on and off for a good period of time. It's been a difficult year, and with the big accident on the start line at Valencia in the first weekend of racing, the car tipped into a very gentle roll, albeit at Francia Corta in the second weekend of racing. It's been an interesting one for you, Mauro.
Yeah, first race, boom, the car exploded on a wall with Alain Lohr in Valencia. Second race, I flipped in Francia Corta. So, and then on the third race in Brands Hatch, I was pushed out by Jacques Villeneuve on the first corner at the second lap. So I finished again next to the barriers. I'm aggressive as a driver, so I understand. But again, what I was mentioning before needs to be taken in consideration, because what happened to me happened also to other drivers. And we get the season ruined by, a lot of competitiveness from the others. Again, it's acceptable, but sometimes we don't need to pass that thin line, because it's going to be, it has to be fun, and you need to find a way to drive in an aggressive mode without creating danger for the others. That's what the only thing I'm saying.
Well, let's hope that is absolutely the case. The pom-pom girls now with their umbrellas heading back off the circuit, which means that we can now just guide you through the grid for this race. So in fact, I can just hear the heavens opening by the sounds of things. Again, the rain really starting to beat down potentially. On pole position, you can see the white car with the lighter green flashes to it. That is Lasse Sorensen. He comes into this race on 493 points, the number 66 car. And alongside him will be number 50, Giorgio Maggi, at the wheel of the Hendrix Ford. That is the championship leading car, just a point ahead, 494 points. And two of them start on the front row of the grid. It really is beautifully poised. Onto row number two, that's where we see number nine, which is the Ford of Alessandro Brigatti, largely black, but it's sort of got orange doors to it to the left and the right. And on the outside of row number two, it's car number 24, Vittorio Garelli, who had a few issues in yesterday's race. We saw on the highlights of yesterday's race, there was a big lock-up on the first lap, and that's because the car in the Elite One race had suffered quite a bit of damage at that first corner incident, and the team PK Car Sport did a great job to get the car back out. However, they didn't have time to do a full setup on it. They also realised there was a small crack in something around the wishbone area, because they'd concentrated on repairing the back of the car, had sorted the front of the car, but there was, again, a small issue there. So Garelli did really well to set the fourth quickest lap time in yesterday's race, hence why he's on fourth on the grid today, the outside of the second row. The third row of the grid is number 99, Justin Kuntz, as the signal has already been given for the drivers to start their engines. And alongside is the car that you race in Elite One, car number 31, Advait Dioda. The fourth row of the grid, number 7, is Martin Dubek, the second of the two Hendrix Fords in the hands of the Czech driver, alongside the Racers Motorsport Chevy in the hands of the Italian race driver who claimed victory in Valencia in the first weekend of racing, Nicola Ricitano. The fifth row of the grid, number 88, Hugo De Sadlier, who was tipped into a spin in the early stages of yesterday, alongside his teammate, the second of the two cars from Racing Engineering, number 48, the American, Myatt Snyder. The sixth row of the grid sees 77, the Chevy from Memphis Racing, of the Scandinavian, Freddie Hemberg, alongside number 70, Michael Bleakey-Molan, Michael Bleekey-Molin leading what is the Legend Trophy within Elite 2 division of the NASCAR William Euro Series. That's for bronze-graded drivers aged 14 over that enter the championship. He's eligible for that without question. He celebrated his 70th birthday earlier on this week, hence why the car has been renumbered from 69 to 70 for this weekend. Row number 7 of the grid is number 12, Nave Talla, alongside 27 Pierluigi Veronesi. The 8th row of the grid is they head off on the first of two formation laps, number 98, Paul van Poelaert, alongside 23 in Erik Vaarden. Row 9 of the grid is two, Jesse Vartiainen, alongside number 11, double former world cyclocross champion Niels Albert. And then the penultimate row of the grid is 54, Arianna Casserly, alongside 64, Matthias Hauer, returning to the championship. The back row of the grid, 78, is Sven van Laar, making his debut in the championship, alongside the youngest driver we've got in the field. Didn't even get the opportunity to race yesterday because the car was so heavily damaged in the Elite One race, it didn't make it out. So number 33, 16-year-old Scotsman Ben Creener, will be used to this sort of weather, hoping to make progress from the tail end of the field, Mauro.
I think he will. He's young, very young. 16 is very young. You don't even have a driver license, and you drive in the NASCAR Elite 2. And he's Scottish, so you're right. They should be used to rain. Let's see. I hope that everybody will warm up the tire in the tires in the right way. It's critical. I think it's not raining at the moment, or is raining not too much. So I wonder what would be the conditions of the tire in the middle of the race. Because if it doesn't rain that much, these kind of tires, they get easily destroyed. So let's see.
Yeah, well, the drivers, as we said earlier on, have had a bit of running in similar conditions, but that was on Friday, so they'll have a rough idea as to where the pockets of standing water might be. You can just see, yeah, there's still a lot of standing water out there. We've only had one other support session out on circuit so far. There was a race just prior to the build-up for this one, so with the break in between the checkered flag for that race and the start of this one, with the weather still closing in, it's still given plenty of time for the water to stand on the circuit. Somebody was saying to me, particularly turn number 3 in the wet, there seems to be a river goes from one side to the circuit. Yes. at turn number 3. That's a tricky part of the track.
Yeah, absolutely. Yesterday when we raced in Elite 1, the conditions were dry, but even if it was raining the day before, we still had this river of water crossing turn number 3. So every time we were safety car deployed,
yeah.
Very good.
I think that means they're going safety car start then in reality. So race control not happy with the conditions at the moment to start the race. So we might have sort of a few laps behind safety car before we can get things underway, Mauro.
And I what do you think? I mean, is going to be because the circuit is very slippery? Or, I mean, I don't understand the real reason of this safety car on the first lap.
I think Philip Goudet sort of indicated in the briefing that if they weren't happy with the conditions, you know, purely this is all for the safety of the drivers and the safety of the marshals, the corner workers that are out there. If they're not happy, they will just start the race under safety car and hope that the conditions improve. And I think some of that is probably as a result of some of the incidents that occurred yesterday. Now we've got the damper conditions, it makes things ever more difficult, doesn't it?
So it means that it could be that the race will go on like this for up to the end?
I would hope not. If that's the case, Lassie Sorensen's the champion.
This is the champion, exactly. Exactly.
That makes the maths nice and easy.
No, I believe it will maybe have some extra laps and then give the go. Because
I think yeah. So. Maybe just two or three. Gives the drivers that ability to fully acclimatise themselves, yes, to the conditions. Because, of course, some of them, a bit like yourself, you know, we had a warm-up session this morning, but that's only 10 minutes. So some of the drivers won't have been out in these conditions this morning.
Absolutely. We have to make a decision because, you know, we have two drivers, one car.
Yeah.
When you look it's not going to change. So the characteristic of this circuit is that even if it doesn't rain, the temperature is very cold. I mean, it's humid, so it's not going to change all day. So I think it's just to give the guys a couple extra laps to feel more comfortable, and then they will go.
And as you said, you know, visibility in these cars is not ideal. And even as you can see at these reduced speeds that they're at the moment, certainly through the exit of turn number 1 and up towards turn number two, which is Sterrenbach booked, then you could see there was a big plume of spray coming out of the cars, and that's bearing in mind they're behind the safety car at the moment. Still working hard, though, trying to build any kind of temperature that you can into these tyres, but in these conditions, as soon as you build any temperature, it probably sort of cools off in the standing water, does it?
I was also very surprised about how good these tyres are in the wet. So they warm up very quickly. I thought that we needed at least a couple laps to warm them up. The slick tires we do, if it's cold, but the rain tires are, you know, they move a lot. All those cuts we have to drain the water are also made to make the tire warm up really fast. So it really handles well. So I'm personally very happy with the rain tires.
I gather from race control we will be having a single file start as and when the safety car heads down pit road. So it will be single file start. Remember the 22-year-old Danish driver, Lasse Sørensen, sitting there on pole position. His brother, Marco Sørensen, has been going well out in Fuji this weekend in the World Endurance Championship. But for the man who has largely cut his teeth in Thunder Sports racing and having raced single-seaters, Formula Renault and Formula 4 and karting many years ago, he is at the moment following the NASCAR path. And let's see what he might be able to do or could potentially. Just 21 years of age, Giorgio Maggi in the number 50 Hendrix car managed to slot it through for a victory. Remember, there's only a point separating them, so whoever finishes ahead of the other would, subject to official confirmation, be crowned the champion. When it comes to the likes of the Legend Trophy, which is for drivers aged 40 and over in the category, well, Michael Bleaky Molan comes into this weekend on 343 points after yesterday's race, whereas Ian Erik Vardin is second in that category on 325. So it's certainly looking as though the oldest driver we've got in the field, Michael Bleaky Molan, subject to a little bit of bad luck coming his way, is still in a good position to maybe scoop up the Legend Trophy.
He's a real legend.
He is.
Because I was talking to him, I met him in Valencia. I knew Bleaky Molan because of his name. You know, he was a Formula One driver.
Yeah.
In the 70s.
77 and 78 with Ram and ATS, yeah.
Yes, and he was racing in the, let's say, old school Formula One. Mm. And he's still there with the same enthusiasm. And now his family is with him, his son, both, I think.
Sebastian races in Nissan, and Jerome races in sports cars.
He was my competitor yesterday. He's very... he's a very good driver. I told him, I would like to be like you at 70, because you still have the energy of a 20 years old driver. You're still there, you don't give up, you push, and you are in contention to win the Legend Trophy.
You've got a while to go before you get to
Michael's
age. Well, if we had you and Ben Creener together, we only just get above Michael's age.
Exactly. So I'm going to put Ben next to me as a co-driver, and we'll compete against Bleaky Molan.
You're still only 2 years older than Michael Bleaky Molan, but yeah, he's a smashing guy. I had a good chat to Michael yesterday, and he's thoroughly enjoyed his first season of NASCAR racing, and we'll wait and see as to what 2020 holds for them as well, because there's going to be a lot of breaking news over the winter. So follow us on social media, whether it be on Twitter, on Instagram, or on Facebook as well, because the calendar will be confirmed shortly. The teams will confirm exactly what they're doing. There is some exciting news coming up over the course of the coming weeks and months in the winter. So follow us on social media at euronascar.com. So the cars still under safety car conditions currently. The race has started now in reality, so they are now on their second lap of what is scheduled to be for this final race of the season, a 15-lap race for Elite 2, but haven't as yet had any confirmation that the safety car will be in at the end of this lap. So I think we might have maybe one more lap behind the safety car, and then we might be able to get things underway. Now, there is one car that I haven't seen circulating, and that is Sven van Laar of the tail end of the field at the wheel of the number 78 Brax Racing Ford. Now, it is Sven's debut weekend in the NASCAR Wheelie Euro Series, albeit he's a Benelux Clio champion back in 2017, but he is not circulating. He is a non-starter in this one for reasons that aren't obvious to us at this stage. The car didn't suffer any damage yesterday, but maybe Sven and the team have had a conversation, and in these tricky conditions, he's perhaps just decided to keep the car in one piece for the Elite One driver, which will be, of course, a Belgian hero, local hero, Marc Huissens.
I think there was an issue with the engine, because I was hearing something strange when the 78 came into the pits after the warm-up, and maybe it was Marc Goosen driving it, and he was going on the gas, like feeling some strange behavior of maybe the carburetor of something on the engine. It was, the sound was not correct, so maybe they're just checking the car to have a good race in Elite One. I was very surprised by Sven, number 78, the guy that is racing with Marc. I think he's a champion with mountain bikes.
Oh, is he? I wasn't aware of that.
I'm not sure. Maybe I'm saying something wrong, but I was asking, you know, what did you do before? And I think I understood or maybe he's a guy in another team. Anyway, doesn't matter.
he's certainly a former Clio champion in the Benelux series. He finished fourth in the Porsche Challenge Benelux back in 2014. We've seen him in Belcar. He's raced at the Spa 24 Hour. He's done a little bit of TCR. And also, he has competed in the European GT4 Championship as well.
So I made a mistake. He's not number 78. The guy I'm talking about is number 98.
Paul van Poller.
Yes, that's the cyclist. I'm sorry, guys. Apologies. You know, it's early in the morning for me.
don't worry, Mara. Don't worry, Mara. We'll get you back to the home in time this evening. Don't worry. So the safety car will be in at the end of this lap. It will be a single file restart, is the confirmation that has been given to us from race control. That will have been communicated to the spotters as well, who will now have communicated that over the spotter to driver radio, that it is single file restart. So we will finally get some racing underway in what are tricky conditions, but the drivers have now had, they're on their fourth lap, so they've had time now to work out exactly what the grip levels are around the circuit.
I wonder, I mean, there is a rule that you need to respect in NASCAR start. You need to stay in formation position until you pass the start line.
Yep.
So now that they are, you know, in line, not in formation, 2x2, I want to see who is going to respect it. Trust me, it's going to be somebody going all over before the cars will pass the start line.
I think, yeah, they won't be in single file order. Somebody will have jinked out of that train before they come over the start finish line. I agree with you. I suspect that might be the case. You never know.
That's it.
So safety car should sort of carry on straight towards our camera. In fact, it peels off there, actually, just towards the right-hand side. It's going to back itself in the gap in the barriers at turn number 15, which is the Jackie chicane. So the pack being led by Lassie Sorensen. Remember, himself, he lies second in the championship, just 1 point away from the car that starts behind him on the grid, Giorgio Maggi. Whoever finishes ahead of who between those two will be crowned the champion, because mathematically nobody else can now do it. So buckle up, we go green for the final time this season in Elite 2. It's a great start from Lassie Sorensen, and they all absolutely behave themselves.
Yes, very well.
Cloud of spray behind, so the cars sort of disappear into the gloom in single file order. For the moment, they're all safely through turn number one. The tail end of the field just working its way through first, though, as they head up towards turn number two, which is Stedevac booked. It is Lassie Sorensen that leads the race at this stage. Giorgio Maggi, his main championship rival, behind him. It looks as though it is Alessandro Brigatti that is there in third position, and Vittorio Gorelli is in fourth place, Justin Coutts in fifth, and Antoine Diodare in sixth place. So not unsurprisingly, with a single file restart, top six remains the same, Marrow.
Yes, I was saying something completely wrong. Those guys behave in a very nice way. Maybe it's more complicated to stay in the position when you do 2x2. Number nine, Brigatti, is a big surprise. Remember, the guy drove a car. I mean, never drove a race car before driving a NASCAR. So this is his sixth race, and he's already, I mean, I think he went on the podium once. And he's a great guy, very humble, very quiet, and he's fast.
Yeah, Alessandro Brigatti really has been a star this year. Yeah, was a driver that's come straight out of karting into NASCAR and has been going beautifully well over the course of the season.
Whoa, touch Arianna and
Matthias Hauer, I think.
Yes,
that was
Hauer.
Possibly, yeah,
yes.
Matthias Hauer, the weird of the Michu Motors car. Another driver that doesn't have a great deal of car racing experience has come out of karting. He's just going through the shop now, which is the black and orange number 12 car of Nave Talor. He was saying to me he's only ever driven one qualifying session in a kart in the wet and Friday's free practice in the wet. Other than that, coming from Israel, he's not had a great deal of wet racing experience. So, a bit of a baptism of fire for him, this one. Over the start-finish line goes Lassie Sorensen, trying to build a bit of a margin between himself and Giorgio Maggi. Lassie Sorensen, 6 wins so far this year. Giorgio Maggi, 3 wins in the book. Alessandro Brigatti still sitting there in third position, with, by the look of things, Vittorio Gorelli settling into fourth place. Vittorio lies third in the championship standings coming into this one. Justin Kuntz is side by side there, and that
Advait passed, yes, I think he passed. Yeah. Advait is a fantastic driver. I don't say that easily. He's coming from Elite Club, and he's, yesterday he lost the podium for a stupid mistake on the last turn. So he deserves to finish higher than the position he has at the moment. But I think he did another mistake, because he's now has been passed by Kuntz and somebody else.
Yeah, I think Justin Kuntz and maybe Martin Dubexen wiggled his way through as well at the wheel of the number 7 Hendrix Ford. In towards the braking area for the Villeneuve chicane comes our leading quartet of cars, really, because it's quite a gap back now, isn't it? Back to fifth place. That's a big mistake and a lock-up, and all through the gravel trap goes Justin Kuntz. Needs to be careful he doesn't gain an advantage as a result of that, but just going to show exactly what you were talking about. You know, a small mistake in these conditions can give you quite a big headache.
Yes. Even if you go in the sand and it's pretty hard, these cars are really low. So the first thing you damage is the aerodynamics. You crash the front wing easily, and maybe some pieces can create the damage on the wheels. So you need to be careful.
We go safety car by the look of things, and I have a feeling I know which the two cars are, because there are two cars that have gone through sector one but haven't gone through sector two at the moment, and that could well be that there are problems out there for Nave Talor and Michael Bleakey Molan, maybe. And yeah, we can see those very two cars, just how I was saying it, in the gravel trap there. They've both got themselves together, which is an enormous shame for the pair of them. That was at Canalbocht, which is turn number 3 here, and that has big implications for Michael Bleakey Molan, because he was leading the standings, the championship standings, for the Legend Trophy. He was on, as I said, 343 points coming into this one. Well, Ian Erik Vaarden is his main championship rival, and Ian Erik is still circulating at the moment. He lies in 15th position overall, and I think we'll pick up the lead of that category as a result of the problems for Michael Bleakey Molan.
Double points will make that, because that's the good thing and the bad thing of the finals and the semi-finals. You can go from one position to another easily. And I think that if he doesn't restart and Ian will stay and finish the race,
yeah,
he will take the lead.
At the moment, he's circulating in 15th. There might be a bit of reordering.
Look at the wiper of Brigatti. Is upside down, and I think it doesn't do much in taking off the rain. So it was very unlucky. Maybe the wind did something, but if we'll keep raining hard, he will have an issue with that.
I assume the teams look at the weather and make sure you put Rain-X on the window to try and disperse the water as much as possible.
We did. We did put some material on the windshield.
Yeah.
We also improved the cooling system inside the car to try to push the air straight in the area where we have to see. Because Friday was a nightmare.
It was a car steaming up inside?
Yes, yeah. Because, these cars, they don't have windows. So, and they're also open behind. So, I was talking to my teammate, Thomas Ferrando, and he was completely wet up to his knees after the warm-up. So the water, it comes from all over. Oh, Bleakey Molan is back in So it's good news for him.
It is good news for him, yeah, because at least he'll be able to keep circulating and should still be in the race. He'll have dropped off the lead lap, of course. That now puts him down into 21st position. Now, that is double points for this weekend, but there are three non-championship drivers ahead of him, so 21st position would ultimately move him up into 17th place in terms of the point scoring, so that would net him 40 points, whereas Ian-Eric Vaarden is currently in 15th, but has two non-championship scoring drivers ahead of him, so that would put him on 48 points, so that would still be enough at the moment, if they stay where they are, for Michael Bleakey-Molin to claim the Legend Championship. The maths at this time of the year are always an absolute nightmare. Yeah.
Yesterday, I was doing the math after the race, because I finished on the podium, let's say luckily, because I had this problem on the last, I had to go on the pits in the last two laps. I thought that Ken Komiura didn't get any points because he didn't finish lap one. But entering the pit, he was able to cross the start finish line and got points, because with the rules that we have, you get points, but you need to complete
one single lap.
So again, based on the calculation that you make, Bleakey-Molin finishing the race will get enough point, even if Ian will be, five or six position ahead of him.
The points go all the way down through the order, and even if you don't complete one full lap, you still get points, but it's 3 points less than the last finisher. Even if you don't start a race, you still get points, because you will get 10 points less than the last finisher. So it doesn't matter what happens, you will accumulate some sort of points, and the likelihood is over the course of a weekend. So safety car still out there at the moment. Any reordering is still in the process of being done, so race control will be in communication with the spotters, who will then relay the information to the drivers as to any changes to the lineup that we've got at the moment. I suspect we're going to be a single file restart again, I would have thought, Mauro, when we get going, because conditions don't seem to have changed since the start got underway.
But they will not change. Again, the water doesn't drain in this kind of asphalt.
Yeah.
And the temperature outside is cold and humid. So single file for sure. I believe that Sorensen, with these conditions, has a small advantage, because Maggi was not able to stay very close to him. So let's see now what will happen. But I see a small advantage for Sorensen at this point.
Yeah, when we have the free practice sessions, I know not every driver's looking for an outright time, but the free practice sessions on Friday, Sorensen was mighty impressive in what were very similar conditions. So I agree with you. I think if I were a betting man, then I'd be inclined to maybe put a few quid or euros in the direction of Lassie Sorensen for this one. But say both drivers have been remarkably consistent this year. They are both rookies in the championship. In fact, coming into this race, the top four drivers in the overall championship standings are rookies: Giorgio Maggi, Lassie Sorensen, Vittorio Garelli and Advait Dioda, which goes to show the young talent that's coming into Elite Two this year.
Vittorio Garelli is from my same area, in Puglia, in Italy.
So right the way down towards the south. Yeah,
the south, the hill of the boot. I was, I knew his father because we are, we have the same age. Vittorio is a very fast driver as well, and I'm so sorry that yesterday he had some issues with the car, because he was really feeling the race, and but it's like as you said, four top guys are new in the championship, and they are rookies, and they behave so well, and I think that all of them can go in Elite One next year with absolutely no issues.
Well, when we had Alan Day, again one of your teammates at Cal Racing, in the commentary box yesterday, you look at what the qualifying time was for Giorgio Maggi at Most in the Czech Republic, and his pole time was quicker than the pole time in Elite One. So we've got some ridiculously quick Elite Two drivers, and we call them rookies, but they're not. They're absolutely not. It's just their first season in NASCAR. They're hugely experienced.
Yes, maybe we should talk to Jerome and tell him to change a little bit the rules about Elite One, Elite Two, Legends, Challengers, because the situation it needs to be analyzed. Some of these guys had also some good careers in go-karting, yep, and maybe other with other cars, and even if they are young, they are fast, and they can compete with pros in the Elite One.
I think it's going to be a very full and very competitive Elite One grid next year, even more so than this year, because I suspect some of these Elite Two drivers will be stepping up next year. It's subject to budgets and availability of cars from teams and things like that. But so lineup is good. Safety car will be in this lap.
NASCAR, is a great championship to come and race because budget-wise is absolutely competitive. When I decided to restart, I had the opportunity with the Swiss team last year, but I got a call from many teams because they knew me since the 90s, and they at the end I compared also the budget, because it's not just the way you drive and how much fun you have driving the car, but you need also to consider how much does it cost.
Yeah.
Is the sponsor happy to give me the money to race? In the NASCAR, the amount of money that you spend is not that high, and the fun is big, and the sponsor is happy because, it's full of people watching it. You have a big media coverage, you have spectators coming to the tracks that other categories will never get. So it's a good combination, it's a good mix between the budget and the return that you get. And the fun for the driver.
It's the whole package, isn't it? And the fact that, of course, the news was announced on Friday when we arrived at the circuit that the affiliation and the support of NASCAR continues for another 10 years. So until 2030, we will have NASCAR represented in Europe as a bare minimum at the moment. So that was fantastic news that was announced by...
The CEO of NASCAR International, I guess.
It was.
I don't remember his name, but big guy in the NASCAR organization. And again,
Gene's definition.
If you win a race here, you have the opportunity to go and race in the US. That's unique.
Absolutely. That will be what our Elite One champion later on when we crown him will be doing, or her, as the case may be, will be doing at Mexico City in the final round of the Mexican Series in early December. So here we go. We're about to get things back underway here. So there are, at the moment, going to be six laps to go as they come over the start-finish line. Lassie Sorensen gets things back underway. Giorgio Maggi with Alessandro Bugatti not too far away. It's still Vittorio Gorelli who sits there in fourth place, and in fifth place, Abba Dioda, did he try? Well, he tried to get up the inside of Justin Coutts, but Justin was having none of it. Bit of a wiggle.
Now he's
going
to try from outside.
Yeah, outside.
Yesterday, Advait did three passes in that turn from outside. That is kind of impressive.
It's the sort of the karting line, isn't it? Around the outside might give you a bit more grip because it's not quite as polished the tarmac, and I think he's made it.
He did it again.
Fantastic stuff for Advait Deodar. Yep, the yellow car, the Cal Racing car that you will be driving in the Elite One race later on. The 31 goes through and ahead of the number 99 of Justin Coutts, but it's Justin Coutts' teammate that still leads at the moment. Now they're all braking right up towards the white line. How careful do you have to be at that point? We're braking on the white line, you don't lock up the brakes on that.
It's slippery.
Yeah.
It's slippery. You need to be careful, avoid to touch anything but the gray area, but it's five laps to the end. They want to go, they will jump on the look at the bike. Okay, safe. Sharing the car, you want first your teammate to compete.
That's Matthias Hauer that's had a spin, so that's the German returning to the championship. We saw him out at Hockenheim. Localised yellow flags, therefore, in that area at the moment. Yeah, you're saying you want your teammate to have a good race.
No,
he blocks the brakes, almost loses the place to Dubeck. You want him to have a good race, but you want him to bring the car back in one piece.
Exactly, exactly. And next year, I'm planning to do Elite 1, Elite 2 with my son that was in the podium of Elite Club this year. So I will think about three things. I want him to compete and have fun. I want the car to be back, and I want him to be safe. Because he's my son.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think Justin Coutts has lost further places. He's really slithered down through the order on this lap four, getting away again as it was before we went safety car. Quite a gap back now to the fifth place car, which is Advait Dioda. Myatt Snyder, the American now for Racing Engineering, has brought his Ford, the number 48, through into sixth possession. Dubeck is up to seventh. Hugo de Sandler is up to eighth. And poor old Justin Coutts, awful, awful lap. He started in fifth. He finishes it in ninth position. So the lead four continuing to get away. We've just actually had the lap that's been completed, the fastest lap of the race. In second place, Giorgio Maggi hunting down his main championship rival, Lassie Sorensen, and keeping him under pressure.
As I said before, I was surprised about Sorensen with a big lead. Now I am absolutely surprised about Giorgio Maggi recovering that distance and putting pressure on Sorensen. I'm afraid that Sorensen is, I call him Iceman, because he doesn't do, you know, a lot of mistakes. So it will be tough for Giorgio to pass him.
Comes from a talented family of racing, really. Does Lasse Sorensen, Giorgio Maggi, was within half a second of him though as they came over the start-finish line for fifth and sixth place. Advait Diodor is under pressure. Look at the squabble that's going on further back through the order there, though, as they head round through the Gilles Villeneuve chicane. So Advait Diodor might have just grabbed fifth place, but Myatt Snyder, the American, is really putting him under pressure. That's the two cars just coming up towards the braking area for Boldeberg.
But he passed now, him. He passed
yeah,
him.
He's through.
He's much faster. And congratulations to Snyder, because in the U.S. you don't race a lot with rain. So looking at him and how he performs under the rain is, again, a round of applause to Matt.
He deserves a bit of good luck, because he was rather disappointed after yesterday's Elite 2 race, which saw him finish in a fairly lowly 19th position when he'd qualified so well. Round through turn number one. At the moment, they are currently on lap number 12 that they have started. This time, the new fastest lap of the race has gone the way of the third place car, Alessandro Brigatti, 1:50.516. In fact, the top six cars all improving their lap times over the course of that particular lap. So it's now three for the lead. Vittorio Gorelli seems to have settled in to what is fourth position. So if Vittorio Gorelli remains in fourth place, then he will secure third place in the championship standings at this stage. So down the straight in towards the braking area for the next of the chicanes they'll go. The order still remaining the same. Lasse Sorensen has led every lap so far. There goes Gorelli looking for fourth position, which, as we say, would net him third in the championship standings. That's the car that will be driven by Nicola Rocca in the Elite One race that we'll see later on. But you can see all of the time Gorelli just dropping further and further away from the lead three, and very much on his own now, isn't he, in fifth position, having got past Advait Diodor on the previous lap. But as you suggested, yeah, Myatt Snyder is disappearing up the road at the wheel of the Ford.
Yes. Big round of applause again to all the three, the top three guys, because if you see the fastest lap time is exactly the same of the warm-up this morning of Alon Day, Steve Longines. I mean, the top Elite One drivers did exactly the same lap time. So they are really, I mean, they are driving really fast.
And I think the lead two are really pushing each
Brigatti
other along.
Brigatti is amazing. I mean, he's, sixth race for the first time, and he's already potentially on the podium again.
Round through to number 12, side by side there. That was Pierluigi Farinacci that was being put under pressure. The leaders come over the start-finish line. Still with Lasse Sorensen under pressure from Giorgio Maggi. The nose of the Chevy dips as he heads onto
he's
the brakes.
Trying.
Round through turn number one. He knows that he's under pressure. Here, Giorgio Maggi. Knows he's under pressure. Lasse Sorensen, I should say, as Giorgio Maggi is right behind him. And Maggi, you know what? New fastest lap of the race. 1:50.328. So he really is doing everything he needs to do. But at the moment, he's got to take the lead of the race, Giorgio Maggi. They are on lap number 13, finishing in second. Is not going to do it for Giorgio Maggi if he wants a championship.
No, it's tight. One point is incredible. Is to how many laps are remaining? Three laps, and Giorgio is going to attack. No matter what, he doesn't have anything to lose.
Absolutely,
he has to go.
Remember, there's no ABS, there's no traction control. This is pure racing in the NASCAR Wheel and Euro Series. There is a yellow and red flag there at the Jackie X chicane. That's just symbolising, I think, rather than oil. It's just a little bit of debris that is on the circuit, just to forewarn the drivers. A bit of fiberglass sitting slap bang in the middle of the circuit. It's off the racing line, rather, so shouldn't affect them. Now, here are the two cars that brought about the safety car period. Looking rather battered is Navitalo's car, the Solaris Motorsport Chevy number 12, under pressure from the team Bleaky Molin Ford of Michael Bleaky Molin. Both of those having had a little trip to the gravel earlier on. I think Michael Bleaky Molin, still circulating, is going to pick up the Legend Trophy title if he stays where he is at the moment.
But, Ian is 12. So I think you should do some calculation, because it will be kind of tight.
It will be very tight. How many non-championship scoring drivers have we got? Bleaky Molin 21st. He would move to 18th in reality. So that would put... Oh, that would give Ian Erik Vaarden it by one single point.
One single point.
At the moment,
oh,
yeah.
Let's see what happens in the next two laps.
Yeah, that's very tight indeed. So
I think Bleaky Molin needs to pass Nave. and same thing needs to happen to Ian. Let's see how many seconds he has. So Ian is back from Vartiainen, I think it's pronounced correctly, one and a half seconds. So I think it just passed him.
Says they come over the start finish line. No, he hasn't. No, but it is rather close. It's still very close also for the lead of the race. Remember, just 1 point separating Giorgio Maggi from Lasse Sorensen in the championship standings coming into this
really
one. The two of them still together as they head in towards the little chicane, the cleaner chicane that's down through turn number five and turn number six. The circuit goes uphill through Sacramentshelling and then downhill again in towards the Villeneuve chicane. It's just two for the lead now. And as they turn their way through the Gilles Villeneuve chicane, I think Alessandro Bragatti has
made a small mistake. He arrived a little bit long on the chicane and he had to go through the cones, but he was lucky enough not to spin the car.
He just got away with it rather there. So what have we got? We're going to be starting the last lap of the race
before
too much longer, so time is running out. A wider turn taken into turn number 12 for Giorgio Maggi to try and get on the power that little bit earlier, but the moment Lasse Sorensen, as he has done all season really, has hardly put a foot wrong, has he, all year.
He's going to protect the line and here we go on the last lap.
Yeah,
so one championship point, one lap to go.
But only one championship trophy available,
sincerely,
I'm afraid.
Sincerely, both of them deserve
absolutely
to be champion.
Couldn't agree more. Remember, Lasse Sorensen has put himself in this championship position and he wasn't even at Valencia. He didn't appear until at round three of the championship, so he missed out on two races in Spain and has claimed more wins than anybody, despite only having done what would it be, 11 13ths of the season in reality. Giorgio Maggi, though, is not going to give up his aspirations to try and make it another win for him. Maggi, could he be on for win number seven of his NASCAR career? And as they head round through turn number four down the straight, time and options are running out for Giorgio Maggi, surely Mauro Trione.
Yeah, let's see. There is another opportunity, definitely, at the breaking of the Villeneuve chicane. But if Sorensen doesn't do any mistake, and then on the last two turns. But again, if Sorensen stays inside the inside lane, there is no way for Maggi to pass from the outside.
Well, here we go then, up towards the Villeneuve chicane. He's going to have a quick look up the inside. Let's hope there's not contact between the pair of them. Sorensen saw him coming and just managed to make sure they positioned the car appropriately. But Giorgio Maggi showed his hand there. And now there's really only a couple more opportunities. One is the one that's coming up now in towards the braking area for Bolderberg, booked. And Giorgio Maggi is going to try that wide sweep going into the corner. He's side by side with Lasse Sorensen. The two of them break as late as they possibly can. This is for the race win and for the championship as well. Alessandro Bragatti is on under pressure from Vittorio Garelli for the final spot on the podium. Now Lasse Sorensen is surely going to go defensive here, but he's got to get off the corner cleanly. That's side by side in towards the final corner. Giorgio Maggi side by side with Lasse Sorensen for the lead of the championship and the championship crown. They come out of the corner together, but Sorensen is just ahead of the Ford of Giorgio Maggi. Lasse Sorensen claims the win and the championship, subject to official confirmation. Giorgio Maggi in second place, and who was third?
Bragatti.
It was Bragatti by a tenth of
a second. Amazing, amazing race. Congratulations to all of them. Sorensen deserved the win, absolutely. He had more win in the championship during the season. As you said, he didn't do a couple of races, so he really deserved. But everybody, I mean, they drove in a fantastic way. It was a great show. A great show for us, a great show for the people at home. And I think they enjoyed driving.
So that would mean that he would finish on 573 points at Lasse Sorensen in the championship, before 564 for Giorgio Maggi. And let's just have a quick look at what's happened in the Legend Trophy.
Let's imagine that he wanted to do donuts, but maybe the car... Oh, here we go.
I think that the message was he's got to wait for all of the cars to take a checkered flag before he can do them. So there we go, celebrating in style. Lasse Sorensen, subject to official confirmation, is the Elite 2 champion of the 2019 NASCAR Whelen Euro Series.
Blake Mullen won the Legend because he's 20 and Ian finished 15, so he's gone.
Your maths is quicker than mine. Well done, Mauro. Let's have a quick look.
So, because you have a non-competing in 16, so he's only four, and I think...
So he's got two ahead of him, hasn't he? So Ian Erik Vaarden would get the points for 13th in reality. because there are two non-competing drivers ahead. That will put him on 373. Michael Bleekie-Molden would also get the points for 18th because of two non-competing drivers.
But Eric has only one non-competing driver. Is this one, number 8.
Ah, right, OK, you're right, yeah. So that would mean that Ian-Eric Vaarden would move from...
So Eric will be 14 and Bleekie-Molden will go 1.
Yeah, he's got it.
2, so he's 18.
Michael Bleekie-Molden is a legend champion, you're right as well. Yep, so that will put him on 381 points compared to 371 for Ian-Eric Vaarden, if I've got the maths right. Because the points did sort of bounce around a little bit overnight as various penalties were given following yesterday's races. So we've done it. We've crowned our first champion, subject to official confirmation, Lasse Sorensen. What a story, really, coming into this championship, having previously competed in single-seaters. Yes, he's got V8 Thundercars experience over in Scandinavia, but missed the first two races. Brands Hatch came from the back of the grid to win a race. He's picked up more race wins than anybody, and he's now the champion.
Congratulations to Lasse. Did he race in the single seats before coming to the NASCAR?
He was a French Formula 4 champion.
Right. How did he fit in a single seat? He's a giant.
I asked the very same question. He said it was before I had my growing spurt.
Right.
He said to me.
Right. I mean, if everybody's worried about, you know, the weight of the car, you know, I have to go in a diet. And then you see Lasse and you realize that doesn't matter. It's only talent. The guy is faster than anybody. I mean, he's really fast, and he weights twice as I weight. I mean, as much as I weight, and I'm heavy.
And that's a double race win for Lasse Sorensen this weekend. So he had ground to make up over the course of the weekend. He came into this weekend 11 points adrift and has now secured the NASCAR Wheeler Euro Series, following the footsteps of Ulysse Delso, who did that back in 2018. Of course, the likes of Thomas Ferrando and Gianmarco Ercoli, all of whom are also former Elite 2 champions and compete in Elite 1 nowadays. All three of those. Are we going to see Lasse Sorensen do the same? The pace, if you can find the budget for next year, then you'd be a tough man to argue that we wouldn't see him in Elite 1.
And you don't want to argue with him, also because of his size and his muscles. So... Yeah. I also want to say congratulations to Advait, my teammate, number 31. He did a great season, close to be on the podium of Elite 2. Pierluigi Veronesi as well, great guy, bomber. He does a lot of things for young kids, charity.
Yeah, clothing company, yeah. Set up for charity, where all the profits go to helping young children with problems.
Absolutely, he's a great guy. He's really into this, and he's promoting this association.
And what's it called?
Sbomber is his nickname, and he created like a charity program for kids with problems in the hospital. Look, he's going to crash the car. He's 2 meters. He's 198. My son is 1.94. But close to Lasse, it disappears.
There is, subject to official confirmation, our champion for 2019 in the Elite 2 division of the NASCAR Wheeler Euro Series. You can see what it means to the Dexwet DF1 team who've had a few problems generally throughout the course of the season, but have turned up to every single round. And on every single round, Lasse Sorensen has, without question, repaid them with performance after performance after performance. And he has been Mr. Consistency this year, Lasse Sorensen. His worst result is going to be a 7th position this year. That is his 7th win of the season. He's had a couple of seconds, he's had a third, and other than that, 7th was his worst. That is a season, isn't it?
Impressive. If he comes to Elite 2, I'm going to go in Elite 2. I'm sorry, if he comes to Elite 1, I'm going to go back to Elite 2, because I'm not going to compete with a guy that is so consistent. Really strong, really cold.
And Lasse won his first race by leading only the last lap. Here, he leads the championship by passing Giorgio Maggi in the very last race of the season. So he's down there in victory lane. He'll be enjoying the moment. He'll certainly celebrate tonight, I'm sure. The team will celebrate as well, because the hard work is done for Elite 2 for the moment. But for the team members, they can't relax. They've got to re-prep that car and get it back out for Elite 2 that The 99 will be competing in of Justin Kuntz. That will be handed over to Guillaume de Flandre in the Elite One, rather. Yeah, you're right. So Guillaume de Flandre. So there is our race winner. Still receiving the congratulations of everybody. The hard work is done. He pops on the winner's hat. He's in victory lane. Let's hear from our winner and our champion.
Lasse, you did it. You are the new Elite 2 Division Champion 2019. How do you feel?
Yeah, it's obviously amazing to be here now. We fought it all season to get in the lead of the championship, and we did it in the last race possible. So I'm super happy for the whole team, Dexford DF1 Racing, and as well my sponsors back home cheering for me all the way.
It was a tough last lap match. He did everything to overtake you. Just talk us through this last lap.
He did. Of course, he had to try to do some overtakes, some stupid ones, in my opinion, to be honest. But he got what he deserved. So second place for him and victory for me. So I'm super happy for everyone.
All right. Thank you very much. Your new Elite 2 Division Champion, Lasse Sørensen.
So there we go. We've heard from Lasse Sørensen. A couple of small comments he made there, and I think it'd be wrong of us not to pick up on them. He thought that there were a couple of moves that Giorgio Maggi did were stupid, in his opinion. Strong words.
Well, yeah, I mean, he had to try, Maggi. From outside, in the Villeneuve chicane, and, it was kind of risky. The move that he did on the last chicane, on the other hand, I think was really brave. And he could have an advantage, but again, Sørensen closed the door. Maybe a little bit hard in saying stupid moves to a guy that is trying to win the title, as you know, he's won, you know.
If the roles were reversed, would Lasse have done anything different?
No,
I'm not sure. Yeah,
no,
I agree
absolutely
with you.
Not. But again, both of them deserve. At the end, only one can win, and will win. And Sørensen won. Maybe more wins in the season made the difference. Congratulations to both. What can I say? It was a fantastic season and a great, great Sunday race in very difficult conditions.
So there, the celebrations continue in victory lane. The celebrations will continue into the night, I'm sure, for Lasse Sørensen and his family. But of course, for the team, they've got to prepare at least one of the cars. Lassie's we won't see out in the Elite One division, but the number 99 that Justin Kuntz has just brought to the checkered flag will be out in Elite One in hands of Guillaume de Flandre. So there's still work to be done for the team. They'll have to wait until all the racing is over to enjoy the moment. That's all we have for you currently here at Circuit Zolder from the final weekend of the NASCAR Wheeling Euro Series 2019. But there's still one more race to come up. There's still another champion to crown as well, and that will be for the Elite One division. We go live with the stream at 15:15 Central European Summertime. If you've been watching in the US, thank you very much for joining us here in Belgium, but go back to bed for a few hours and set your alarm, because the stream goes live at 9:15 Eastern Standard Time. From Mauro Trioni, who joins me in the commentary box, thank you, Mauro. From myself, Mark Burrell, goodbye from Circuit Zolder.
Goodbye to everybody, and see you later for the Elite One race. Bye-bye.
Good morning and welcome to Autodromo di Francia Corte. Welcome to Brands Hatch for round 6 of the 2000. Welcome to Circuit Zolder for the final round. The lights go out, the green flag flies. It's all very tight up towards turn 1. Oh, it's close and there's contact. They're side by side. When the checkered flag falls and the race is done, there's always time for celebrations.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100,